question of what has been going on in Egypt lately. It's brought to you by the Center for Human Rights and Civil Liberties, which is a group that consists of a lot of human rights group-oriented groups on campus. Sorry, I assume everyone can hear me because I'm always loud. Is it on?
It's not on.
Sorry, can you hear me? I'll just talk like this, but I'm going to fix that. Okay, tonight, it's going to be a discussion. I want everyone, well, we all want everyone who has questions to participate. There is a panel that's going to be up here, and we do have a few really broad discussion questions to ask them. But really, any questions you ask, don't feel timid. Just raise your hand, and you can ask. You can either field a question to someone specific on the panel or just a broad question. Don't feel nervous about it. Okay. So, and tonight's focus is to not just talk about the facts of what we've been hearing on the news about Egypt, but also reflect on what that means to not just the people of Egypt, but the Middle East in general. So hopefully it'll be really colorful, fun discussion. First off, we're going to have a movie, a short film YouTube video that shows us visually what's been happening in Egypt, and it lasts about 9 minutes. And directly following the film, we're going to have a moment of silence to just reflect on the people who did lose their lives in this revolution. So.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, now I would like to introduce our panel. We have what really is two panels. One person who's in Egypt, his name is Ahmed Abdelzaher, and he was actually recruited by USM to run track and field. He's a USM graduate, and he's currently pursuing his PhD in computer science from USM. So he's definitely a part of us, our USM community, but was in Cairo during the revolution that took place over the past few weeks. Our Hattiesburg panel includes Mohamed Ismail, who is a psychology student at the University of Southern Mississippi. He's also the president of the Arab American Association. We have Dr. Nagwa Megahed. She is a Fulbright-in-Residence scholar. She teaches Arabic and Middle Eastern studies classes here. One day I'll learn to speak better. And then we have Dr. Dia Ali, who is also a professor at USM. He's in the computer science department. In addition to our panel on Egypt, we have Dr. Isaac Gong, who after the Egyptian panel discusses, you know, our discussion questions and fields any questions from you guys, he's going to come up and talk about the Sudanese connection to the Egyptian revolution in addition to just the Middle Eastern connection to what's been going on. So, okay, and that's our panel. If you guys would like to come on. Oh wait, I'm sorry, one more thing. Dr. Bob Press is going to be fielding the questions to the panel, so he's also with us today, and round of applause for him too.
Thank you, Emily. Emily wanted to make clear that everybody is most welcome to ask questions at any time. This is not the usual forum where you'll hear some long talks and you have to write down your question and then say it at the end. But maybe for just a couple minutes to get it started, I'll ask a question of the panel, of each member, and then in Ahmed also. And then if you have a question, just raise your hand and I'll come stand near you and you can shout it out and I'll repeat it so that we make sure that Ahmed gets that in Cairo. And Dee, if I can start with you. You were actually an activist in the past against Nasser. And how do you feel about what happened now that didn't happen some decades ago?
Well, I feel that my generation failed. And those kids teach us a great lesson. For us, we just failed, and some of us left the country, and we kept running. And we thought that we'll never see this day again. Sorry, because this is the first time I see this movie on a big screen, and it is very hard to see. But anyway, I'm really jealous that I'm here. But I don't think I'm not going to run anymore. And I didn't want my family to be raised in that country. But now I'm very proud. And for sure we are coming back.
Thank you. And Mohammed, younger generation here only briefly for a year or two, and you're going right back. What's your impression of what happened?
Well, I think it's a great step and it's a great process that we're going through, and of course all the changes that are going to happen in the future or whenever they do happen are going to be for a great cause. And I mean, I would like to take credit, or our generation to take credit, but as well, as you saw in the video, it was everybody. It was the entire population. It was the people, not just our generation or Dr. Dea's generation, but it was everybody who was concerned for Egypt's future and for Egypt's and to secure Egypt's just title as a well-deserved nation and as a strong nation. So, yeah.
And Dr. Megahed, your impressions of what happened?
Well, I'm definitely very inspired, even when I watch this videos, it's just very inspiring. And I should admit, I also felt very frustrated by the government's first reaction against the protesters. And this hit me badly with the beginning of the revolution, to see Egyptians fighting Egyptians by the police force. This was very frustrating, but I was very inspired by the determination of all Egyptians to confront this police state and be able to bring back to every Egyptian our country. So this is what we feel, this is what I feel today, that we have our country back. We realize that we have a big challenge ahead. We know that it's very critical. This is the beginning, not the end, definitely. But I'm optimistic, and I really hope it's the beginning of a bright future for Egypt.
Thank you. Now, Ahmed, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. You were in Tahrir Square, and I'm wondering if you could share with us briefly, and we'll come back to you many times, and there'll be questions for the panel and you. What was it like to be in Tahrir Square, which at times got very dangerous?
At times where it was really dangerous, and at times when it was really happy, every single hour in there was as if Egypt has won the World Cup. Which we hope one day would happen.
Well, tell us a little about your experience on Tahrir Square, please.
Well, my experience was just like most of the people in the crowd. I shouted with my loudest voice that we need the removal of the regime. I got actually exposed to tear gas. I wasn't exposed to rubber bullets, but I can see like people around me getting exposed to rubber bullets. I saw buildings burning, and it was as if they were in a parade of too many people. And all I really can remember is the funny stuff that people would come up and say, the stand-up comedies, the you know, people trying to entertain themselves, the people sitting on the sides of the street, people figuring out a way to bring electricity, people figuring out a way to dispose of their waste. That'd probably be everything in the summary of my experiences in Tahrir.
Okay, and I want to thank you, in your initial remarks, and again invite the audience. Dr. Dia has been here for a number of decades, represents a different point of view, was an activist against Nasir. Mohammed is a younger generation who's going to go back, perhaps. Maybe he'll linger in Hattiesburg forever. We don't know yet. This is Dr. Nagwa Megahed, who is the Fulbright Scholar here for her second year. And then Ahmed, who is a computer science study, getting a PhD. So let me open to the audience now and ask any questions. And I know I spoke with a gentleman when he first came early. He said, I have a wild question. And it turns out it's not that wild. Some Egyptians have been asking the same questions. So over to you. And then I'll come back and ask some more. And we'll just keep it flowing like that. This is not the only question and answer period. It's the first of many. Well, the gentleman with the wild question, okay. You shout it out, and I'll try to repeat it.
Did you see this coming, and is it tied to Tunisia?
Okay, he's asking one of the panel members here or there, anyone wants to answer, this is the question. Did you see this coming or not?
Well, I should speak for myself, because I have been here for, this is my second year. I visited my country in the summer. But I would tell you that I didn't see it coming. My husband did. And my husband told me on January 24th that January 25th will be a big day in Egypt. And it's a beginning of a real revolution. And I should admit that I expected it's going to be a small protest. We had several small protests, you know, during the last 5-6 years in the country. The government was always able to control it by using this heavy police force in the first day. But what was very inspiring is how people will really also inspired by what happened in Tunisia, definitely. And I was away, and I didn't feel what they felt during that time. My husband did, because my husband spent more time in connections with people in relation to his work as a journalist. Clearly, Egyptians, yes, inspired by the success of Tunisian in removing their regime, and decided that they also should do the same. If it's and we know the Egyptian situation is different. It's more the country of Egypt has its very strategic importance in the region. So, and of course, it's much bigger in terms of it's the largest in North Africa in terms of the population. So it was even more challenging, but they succeeded.
Can I have another question, please? Yes, sir, I heard one here.
Dr. Abdia, your generations saw the first revolution against the king. And his generation, we saw now the revolution against a dictator. How you compare the first revolution to the second one, please?
Well, I think the first revolution, we trusted the military too much. They start in a good, we start with good hope. We trust them that they are going to change everything. And then 50 years later, we know that don't trust the military more than 2.5 months. And after that, they have to go. If they stay, if they stay more than that, you are in big trouble. And, you know, I think that's what those guys are doing now. Every day, there was a committee called the Wise Men. And the Wise Men, they called them the Wise Men, they called themselves. And they were advising those kids to go home and say, go home now, because otherwise we are going to lose everything. Thank God they didn't listen to them. And this is why it is going, and it's still going. The revolution just started. They did the first step. And I hope they don't listen to the Wise Men. And I hope they don't trust anybody over 35 years old.
Another question? We have a question down here.
I have a question as to, now that President Mubarak has stepped down, and there's the aspect now of the military being in control of Egypt, for many of us in the United States, this is kind of foreign to have military control, I mean, otherwise, other than the Reconstruction period of the Civil War. So, are you all confident that the military will actually now hand back power to civilian control, civil government? And what are some of the, what lies ahead next for Egypt? I mean, now, I mean, the question that Dr. King asked here in America, where do we go from here? Where does Egypt go from here?
Excellent question. Ahmed, can I give you that question? You didn't hear it directly, but he wants to know, do you trust the army and what happens next?
All right. For me, I only trust the army until we get our new president. And for me to continue going back to bed and sleeping on my own bed comfortable is for me to actually see these elections being done in the right way. Everybody has to have his own unique ID. The elections need to be recorded on camera. Every government official standing on an election box has to be governed by a civilian official that will be looking whether he is going to be cheating, filling his own election papers by himself or not. Things like that that needs to be focused on by the people. And not even if the military was the most corrupt military on earth, if the people stood together and they would watch over these little things, they will make a great change. It's in our hands, actually.
Thank you. We have one more question, maybe, and then we'll go back. I'll suggest a few others. Okay, we'll have a second and third chance. Mohammed, are you going to go home?
Well, I'm going to be honest. The first 2 days, I thought I wasn't with it. I thought it was very unorganized. I thought it was very not well structured. But then after the events that happened with the police and the population, I was ready to go back, honestly. And again, after seeing this video with the dramatic music, I was like a 5-year-old child in that chair. But going back to that, I'm only gonna go back to help. And if I have to stay there, it's to help. Regardless of what I'm gonna be doing as an individual or as a group with people I know or not. If I go back, regardless of who's gonna be the leader, they know what the people are capable of. So if we're gonna go back, we're gonna be able to make a change. Just like Ahmed said, no leader is gonna put themselves in the position of where another revolution will unfold. And if we go back, then it's gonna be a peaceful nation. And as they demonstrated, they're gonna get their demands, because it's unfolding now, as everybody has been saying, it's the beginning of the revolution, not the end.
Well, some people are also saying, is this perhaps manipulated by outside forces and not a genuine revolution? I want to ask you that question, Mohammed, and then go to Ahmed and see what he thinks, too.
Is there outside forces? Is that the question?
I'm asking it, are there?
I doubt it, because if there were outside forces, then all that has been accomplished would have not been accomplished. Because everything that was demanded from the beginning, if we look at it from the beginning, it was the demands were very simple. It was more occupations, minimum wage, and human rights. But due to the population feeling as if they didn't have a voice in the country, that's why they began to revolt against the main source, which was the president. And now asking if there was an outside source, I doubt that. Because if there was an outside source, then the people wouldn't have been able to make the changes that they've made now. And if there was an outside source, everything that we've seen is just false, which I highly doubt.
Ahmed, do you want to come in on that?
Yeah, I would like to add on that, President Mubarak has been ruling for 30 years. So 30 years ago, a child was born, and his mother the family paid so much money to educate him, and while he's growing, he needs expenses. And all these tutors and all these schools and classes and paying so much money, and then he goes into college and they pay even more money while he's in college. And after that, he comes out at the age of 23, sits at home, or sits at a cafe, doesn't do anything, he doesn't find a job, he can't get married, he can't find another place to live outside his parents' house. His parents are demanding too much, and he's getting irritated. He can't stay with his parents, and he wants to get married. And he's very educated, but he can't excel. All this happened in a span of 25 or 30 years. It was so predicted. Me coming out of college, I was like, this will happen. Everything will happen. What you just saw, I wasn't surprised. I was like, this will definitely happen. How come you hear of people getting so much pay and you can't even get a job? So that would be my additional comment to Mohammed.
Do we have any Facebook users in the crowd? Could you just raise your hand if you use Facebook? All right. Well, then you're all part of the revolution. Congratulations. Would anybody in the audience like to explain how Facebook helped this revolution take place? You might have read something about that. Sure. Go ahead.
I was following up with books and confusion, and I saw it's coming, because it's the people who called for the protesting on the 21st of January, he said for the first time, our call spread to over a million people on Facebook. That never happened with them before. And 300,000 people said they are attending on the 21st, and that never happened before, of course. So I felt like I started following up with the call, because the call was almost like two weeks early. So, and I was following every day what's happening, updating comments and everything. So I felt it's coming. And especially with their experience, of course, I have been here for a long time. So with their experience back with breakfast protesting, they said, no, this is different. It's going to be definitely different. And we saw what happened on the 21st.
Thank you. We're shifting, as you can see, from the what happened to how it happened. And our third phase is going to be what next. So while we're on the how it happened, do we have some other questions? Do people have questions? Yes, just holler it out and I'll pass it on. Ahmed, you have a lady waving to you from the back row.
You have secret admirer.
Did y'all hear me?
Yes.
Or should I repeat?
I didn't hear the question.
Okay. So you repeat it because he can't hear you without the mic, but I heard you.
Just go ahead and repeat.
Dr. Nagwa, you can tell me the whole thing.
وضع المرأة مكانة المرأة من خلال الثورة هتبقى وضعها ايه بعد كده تفتكر خاصة ان مبارك
She will repeat it for you. I'm talking about right now the condition of women. How do they feel about the whole about what happened in Egypt? We saw pictures of women protesting, but it was almost a ratio from one woman to 1,000 men. And being in Algeria, we did hear, I heard a lot about what Mubarak had done for the condition of women, the emancipation of the Egyptian women. And so my question to you, Ahmed, and to Dr. Nagwa, what is the Egyptian woman thinking? Is she a tad bit worried? We've heard also, that the constitution may be ratified right now in Egypt as allowing now religious group to hold a political party. This could be a tad bit scary. And I know from being from Algeria also, I, as a woman, would be a tad bit worried. Thank you.
Go ahead, Ahmed, and then Dr. Megwa will follow up on that.
What I got from the question is like, well, how were most women feeling about this revolution? And my answer to you was like, they were 100% supportive when we were downstairs protecting the streets because, you heard of the prisoners, I don't know if the video showed it, but after the police wasn't able to stand against the people, so they retreated. The army came, stood by the people, and then some person, we suspect it's the police who actually did this because it was so obvious, released the prisoners out of all the prisons in Egypt and told them, just go produce chaos. So we have to go downstairs and protect our houses. We have to protect our arms and protect everything that we have with whatever old weapon that we can lay our hands on. The ladies, they were sending us food every hour or two, like cake. Stuff like that. So they were 100% supportive. Once they were staying in the house in their houses or apartments or in the buildings. Of course, I don't know if you've seen the pictures. There was a girl who actually died in the protest. She was shot by live ammunition. So that should also send a message about how even the ladies were suffering from what was going on, and they wanted, they wanted to get married. They wanted jobs. They wanted their place.
My comments will be phrased to what next, and we are definitely at the crossroad, if you will, so we can move either way for women. It's either backward or forward. So I agree with you. The first lady, former first lady, definitely did a lot for women's emancipation and liberation, for sure. However, there were still a lot of problems in terms of high literacy rate among women versus men. It's, they may surprise a lot of you, but it's 44% of women over age 15 are illiterate in Egypt. So there were women from all ages and all level of education and even illiterate who participated in this revolution. And I assume they expect that they will have their rights as equal citizens to men in this country. So they have their expectations as well. So where we are heading, it's a big question mark. You pointed to the how the Ban Group Muslim Brotherhoods is now recognized by the government. It's not a Ban Group anymore. It's even constituted its own party, political party. It's by the former constitution. Some of you may don't know, but the former constitutions didn't allow to form any parties based on religion. So now, this is, we are still working on the new constitutions, but there are also different interest groups in the countries, in the country, that try to gain as much as they can during this transitional period. And one of the gain was definitely for the Muslim Brotherhood. This shouldn't scare us in the meantime, because the Muslim Brotherhood is not a radical group. Muslim Brotherhoods in Egypt specifically, I would be very specific. They hold the conservative ideology or thinking, but they are not radical, they are not violent. And I will give you one example for that as an evidence. When Ayman al-Zawahiri turned to be a radical, violent man, he was out of this group directly. The other example is jihad group who assassinated Sadat. It's also been really moved from the Muslim Brotherhood. So the Muslim Brotherhood, they may have different level of ideology as Muslims in terms of being more conservative, but they are not radical, they are not violent. So they also look for democracy from their own Islamic perspective, which may lead. We will witness together. So if we went that, you know, this way or that way, how the situation for women will be.
Let me talk about you talk about the Muslim Brotherhood. Let me talk about the organization. First of all, those are very smart kids. They select the 25th of January. Because this is the days the regime celebrates the policemen. And they know that all the policemen are hated. So the selection of the day shows that it was a genius idea, because everybody has complained against the police when went to the street too. The other thing, organization-wise, the Muslim Brotherhood, they were the only organized group in the country. And they were scaring everybody because they can't go to the street. Now, those kids, they prove that they can get a million people in the street just like this. So the Muslim Brotherhood, now they are not the only effective organization. Organization is the most important part in any revolution, to do it in the time, to do it smartly. And I think now we have better understanding of how they move the street. And the Muslim Brotherhood, I don't think their power is much less now on the street than those kids.
Mohammed, you had a comment too. Thank you, Dia.
I had a comment to your question, just presenting it through a younger generation's point of view and shedding light upon the younger women who are from my generation. Seeing that you've seen women who have died through the revolution, they know that they have a voice now, because it's not only a revolution of freedom, but it's a revolution of equality as well. So if the Constitution is laid down and it and women do not have rights, then you can expect women to ask for rights, because now the population knows that they can ask for what they want. And women in my generation, I've seen through Facebook and through Twitter that these young women have created groups and have created albums of what they're doing on the streets. For example, cleaning up or or asking for equality. And today, earlier today, during the interview on WDAM, right before my interview, they showed a clip on the feminist movement, and this lady was asking that now that the revolution has begun and now that it's going into process, that women should have a voice as well. And of course, there are people that are debating this due to the different subcultures, but women there are very educated, and women there have a voice, and if they don't get what they demand, then I think it would probably be just, in my opinion, it would probably be a woman's revolution. That's all I'm saying.
Thank you. I want to now introduce our next speaker, final speaker, Dr. Isaac Gang, and he's going to talk with about something else that's happening in the neighbor. We're going to look at what next in a larger regional sense. Sudan, as you probably know, is going through the most important moment of its history, which makes it the most important moment, one of the most important moments in African history. It's the largest country. He'll tell you what's about to happen. Dr. Isaac Gang.
Thank you, Dr. Price. I just want to tell you guys that what is about to happen is it's not as simple as you may think. It's more of a culmination of the whole process, of the whole event. You know, we want to give you the Egyptian point of view and then kind of look at this event in a regional sense or in the regional point of view. Quickly, when we came up with this idea, well, actually, we didn't come up with this idea. I think Dr. Alan McBride came up with the idea, but Dr. Perez and I discussed this, you know, at lunch and say that, don't you think it'd be a good idea to have forum in Egypt? And I was like, yes, definitely, that'd be great. I know some great people that would be very helpful in giving another perspective of the Egyptian people. And I contact my professor, Dr. Dia Halim, Dr. Abumel, and tell them about this idea. And my idea about this event obviously was to let you guys know, the people on campus, the campus community, know about the Egyptian revolution. But when Dr. Fred asked me, can I speak a little bit on the Southern Sudanese secession or what happened in Southern Sudan, I was kind of tentative because I feel, how is it going to relate to the Egyptian point of view? Maybe we need to change the title to Egyptian Forum and Southern Sudan. But I think about this for a little while and realized that actually what happened in Egypt has major similarities with what happened in Southern Sudan. And that's when I say that, yes, I can definitely say a few things and maybe share some things about the event in Sudan and Southern Sudan in particular. So basically, if you follow the news, I know it's not on the news a lot, but what happened on July the 9th, 2011, was considered at the time the single most important political event of the year, because how often do you see a new country being created? How often do you see people voting for a chance to create a new country? By show of hands, how many people in here were there in 1776? Yeah, there's no one. You know, I doubt no one was. But just imagine the feeling, the idea of being here, you know, when a new country is created. That's kind of what was happening at the time when the secession vote took place in the country of Sudan. And so I'd say, you know, this is a very important event that the campus community should be interested in knowing. And I would jump on the idea to make sure that, you know, we include this here. Briefly, just about the referendum. The referendum, obviously, is an event that allows people to choose what they want, you know, in their government or in their society. So the idea to have a referendum came as a result of a 2005 peace agreement between the Sudanese People's Liberation Movement and the government in the north, because in the past 56 years, there had been a civil war between the north and south, and this was considered and still is considered the longest civil war in Africa. And so, in 2005, there was an agreement signed to allow the people in the Sudan to be led by President Bashir, which most of you know. And then after a 6-year period, the people of Southern Sudan will evaluate his performance. You know, they will evaluate what he had done in the last 6 years, and if we can maintain that arrangement. And that arrangement was a coalition government between the people of Southern Sudan and the Northern Sudan, and then and the Tarim government in the southern part of the Sudan. And so if the people of Southern decide that they don't like the current arrangement, which is the government of national unity, they have the choice to become independent. And so on January the 9th, 2011, that happened, and basically the choice was very clear. 99.9% people in the South voted for a separate country. And what I want to do now, just briefly, because when this happened, you know, I want to show you the kind of similarity that I was talking about. What similarities do the Southern Sudan succession have with that of the Egyptian Revolution? The first part, you know, the person I will show you, just a video right before the success, you know, the succession vote, that was recorded, you know, showing people.
The march towards independence in southern Sudan, a referendum on formal split from the North Province on Sunday, and the Yes Camp are confident of their cause.
Make it feel, can I make it?
Nearly 4 million Southerners, most of them Christians, will be able to cast their vote. The final stage of the 2005 peace accord between North and South that put an end to more than 20 years of civil war. Sudan's president... But even if the country decides to divide, there remains the question of the border itself, and especially the oil-rich region around Abyei, recently the source of much North-South tension. And separation may also set a precedent for wider Africa, encouraging similar struggles in countries still bound by their colonial-era borders.
And quickly, thank you. Right. Yeah, you know, basically what, you know, what I want you to get out of that video is that no matter where this incident happened, the people yearning for freedom is a very common phenomenon that we should pay attention to. So, you know, what you've seen was before the referendum, and this was the anticipation of what will happen in the, you know, the few days. So during the referendum, a lot of people were very motivated, as you can see in the Egyptian square of Tahrir, to make sure that they participate in this event. And I will take a few minutes to show you just a few video, you know, few pictures to show you what the mood was when people were voting. And this, obviously, this was in the United States, because during the referendum, the centers were set up in countries outside the, in outside Sudan. So this, you know, what you're about to see here is the mood in the U.S. here during the referendum. This is a line in the Omaha, Nebraska station. You know, people wake up at 2 in the a.m., and they stand in the line the whole day because the staff were not big in number, and you know, the process was long, but you know, they were determined to stay here as long as it took so they can vote. So the point I'm trying to get across here is that no matter what, you know, what we think, the desire of the people that we see in the faces of those in the line is the same thing we've seen in the faces of the Egyptian people in Tahrir Square. And you know, what we should be aware of is that what conclusion can we make? Because in the year 2011, we've seen some things that we've never seen before. As for my own conclusion, and this is, you know, this is probably the last, you know, the last point, so we can, you know, get to the question, is that whether, you know, whether we're talking about a frustrated college kid who cannot get a job in Tunisia and set himself up on fire because he was frustrated, that triggered a series of protests that overthrown a dictator of 24 years, or a Facebook user who was frustrated about the events in Egypt and started a group that galvanized the whole nation to start a revolution in Egypt and eventually resulted in the overthrow of a dictator in only 18 days. Or we can look at the event in southern Sudan that a 56-year civil war that ultimately ended in a succession vote to leave the dictator by himself and to have his own country. So all of these events have one thing in common. People cannot tolerate dictatorship, and people want freedom. So the message there is clear. All the dictators and all the dictators want to be have been put on notice that you will either put up with what we want or it's not going to be business as usual. So whether it's Egypt, Sudan, or Tunisia, or Yemen, or Libya, you know, these people will, you know, they will hear the voice of the people. If they don't hear the voice of the people, they will have a heck of a ride. And I want to stop here so that we could maybe ask some questions on what I just shown here. And maybe, you know, just broaden the context of the discussion of what's happening in the Middle East. Thank you.
We'll open this up for another round of questions for Dr. Gang, or for Ahmed back in Cairo, or for Dr. Megahed, or Mohammed, or Dr. Ali. Any questions are fine. Yes, sir. Right. I think we had one, two, and three. We'll take four in that area. You've had one? Okay. I don't know if we'll have time for a second one.
With the several other nations who have, with the Middle East, with the way it is, a lot of people in this region especially are concerned with a theocracy taking place afterwards. I was wondering if there is a difference between this revolution and previous ones in other places. Why is this one different, and what is the outlook for maybe the religious minorities, the peoples in Egypt? Thank you.
Anyone? We'll give Ahmed a chance to raise his hand if he wants to. Otherwise, anyone on the panel here? Okay.
I am. I don't know if anybody raised their hand, but I can answer. But
go ahead.
Mike, Dr. McGann, because she would know better.
Either one.
Go ahead. I will follow you. Just go first.
Well, the main thing that our friend has directed the attention of the audience is that if the people agreed, if the people agreed on something, it will make them satisfied. Now the people are agreeing on democracy. Now if we were to use correct democracy, where everybody has his own unique ID and to give his own unique voice, and then the end result was a theocracy, then that theocracy is based on democracy, then it shouldn't make anybody. Shouldn't make anybody dissatisfied or disappointed from the result of democracy. And that would be my comment.
Well, first of all, it's not a religious revolution, clearly. So there wasn't any specific religious demands even on the agenda at all. And as we have seen, the participations included all different kinds of people, and definitely Christians, Egyptian Christians, who stood shoulder by shoulder to Egyptian Muslims calling for freedom. To what extent we may be heading toward a theocratic state, it's a big question mark. But I believe that what we are witnessing, whether in the region or outside the region, is the birth of the new Middle East. And everybody needs to get ready to understand this new Middle East, because it might be a religious Middle East, but I would ensure you one thing. It will not be Iran, it will not be Turkey, it will not be any previous model of Islamic State. It will be the Egyptian model of Islamic State in Egypt, which I believe will basically show to the world a liberal Islamic State that we, I'm very optimistic, maybe you think I'm very optimistic, but this is what I hope, based on my knowledge and based on my experience with Egyptians, I'm one of them. So even if they will build this new state or government in a religious framework, if you will, because I don't think they will go that far to call it Islamic State. I think it will be its own model.
One thing we didn't show here, when the Tahrir Square, when the police were attacking, and the Muslim were praying, and the Christian was protecting them while they were praying. And the other thing, once the police disappeared from the street and there was no police, all the church were safe, nobody complained about anything, and we discover now that the government actually destroyed the church like 3 months ago by the government, by the central government, to create this thing. So I think we are going to be okay as long as people and authority, they don't try to play this game. And it is just a game, which is a very bad game. And I'm sure that we are going to be okay.
We had a couple over here, but were any of them on Sudan? Okay, well then let me ask one of Sudan. You've changed? Okay. I have one of Sudan, and I think I know Dr. Gang well enough to ask this bluntly. Eritrea was excited when they voted, same thing as Sudan, voted for independence from Ethiopia, became a total autocratic police state. Everybody cheered when Rwanda became independent, and then it's a police state. Will Southern Sudan be democratic, or will it just be one more police state?
Is that your question or someone else's question?
This is mine.
Well, thank you. That's a very legitimate question. I think one of the reasons I'm very optimistic about Southern Sudanese succession is because we have seen enough. You know, we have seen countries succeed and succeed or get independence and then change to something different. So what I can say so far is that from what I'm seeing or from the circumstances on the ground is that this, all signs are pointing to the right direction, that people will have a very acceptable model of democracy, that everyone is given the right to praise themselves as well as to choose their religion. I guarantee one thing: if there seems to be a dictatorship tendency, I'll be the first to call for intifada or something similar to what's happening in Egypt. We have seen enough, and now we see that the people have power. If something goes wrong, we could take it to the street and we can change things. So I'm very optimistic about what will happen in Southern Sudan.
Thank you. And if you turn dictatorial, I'll be the first one to come talk to you.
Assalamu alaikum. Alaykum as-salam.
Wa rahmatullahi.
I know that much of this revolution was broadcast on YouTube, but I know at my house and in many other houses, in other Arab Americans' homes, TVs were turned to Al Jazeera, or rather satellites and laptops. Do you think that this revolution and any other activities in the Middle East will finally, like, it'll finally be the time for Al Jazeera to come into America?
And you mean to come to America, not to be, is it banned here? It is. Yeah. Okay, I know that Al Jazeera has its own English channel, and it's definitely people's choice to watch which channel they prefer and which they feel it provides the accurate kinds of picture. We know that during the time of the revolution, Al Jazeera did that. And in this case, I would say people would definitely choose to watch Al Jazeera because it was the only source that's able to provide information, live information from the region. So, okay, Bob, I got that. Sorry,
a very
stop.
Short comment.
Okay, actually, this is a very important point because during the revolution, the Egyptian TV and the newspaper, they were ignored completely as nothing happened. Actually, they were faking pictures from Tahrir Square, and they said this is for Mubarak. And this is what happened when you have all this thing with the government. The press has to be independent, has to be free, and this is why people were going to the Gazir.
Dr. Bia, I would like to add on to that, that today, about 2 hours ago, there was it was broadcasted that the Ministry of
Yeah, I would just like to add for everybody who was curious, especially in my home, regardless of whether it was CNN or any other American news broadcast, if we wanted to find a source, we could definitely find it, and that was through the internet. And I know, like my father, for example, being a journalist and knowing all the pathways to news, he was able to find Al Jazeera and even the Egyptian the national TV, the local channels for Egypt. So everybody that was curious and everybody that wanted to be informed about the happenings in Egypt tuned in through a variety of ways that they wanted to see it, just in addition to everybody else's comments.
And just a personal note, my wife and I have been streaming it onto our television and watching Al Jazeera every night.
The United States has been a huge supporter of the Mubarak regime through Republican and Democratic administrations. How much animosity has this created among Egyptian people, and how will that affect Egyptian foreign policy in the future?
Well, it's an excellent question, of course. But we have heard that from the current Supreme Council of the military, of the army, which is basically ruling and leading the country during the transition, that they respect and will keep all their foreign policies and, you know, regional and international treaties as it has been. I don't think, at least, there will be dramatic shift or change. However, again, we are now in a transitional period in which the change is just moving very, very fast. The information we have so far, the military, the army in Egypt respect the relationship with the US and other foreign countries. They will move toward the moving the country toward the free elections, the more democratic states, which supposedly will be welcomed by the West. But the dynamic of this, it's also portrayed by the voice of people. And it's not just by the voice of who is in power or in charge. So how that change will take place, it's very ambiguous. But we hope it will continue toward promoting, you know, cooperation and collaborations in several sectors.
Let me say something very straight. The problem that you want to be free, but you want us to be under dictatorship to keep your interest. And this is not fair, and this is how people are starting looking at it. So actually, if you want to be free, you have to be free too. Dictatorship will never help you against the people again. And this is why the American were going from one place to another, and they lost a lot of credibility, to tell you the truth. And Obama went to Cairo, to University of Cairo, and he said something, but when the time came, they were saying something else every day according to what the news is. But it is about time. If you are free, I have to be free too. And then we'll work on friendship more than an interest. You think that my dictator will give it to you.
Some more questions. Okay, we got a lot of them. Can we keep them very short and holler it out? Yes, sir, you. On using the internet.
Yeah. Would it make sense to use the internet, online social networking, in constructing the Constitution? This is a question for anybody.
Would it make sense to use the internet in getting ideas on how to construct the Constitution? Maybe, Ahmed, you could take that since you were actually attracted to Tahrir Square through the Facebook.
It's already started. Everybody is proposing ideas. Everybody has his own ideas of how this country should run. They're creating all these groups, how to increase the jobs, how to increase the greenery in Egypt, how to provide food, how to, you know, help the financial crisis, all this. People are on the internet constantly proposing ideas. But you can't use the internet just to actually do the change. You can only propose the ideas, other people can monitor it and apply it, but you can't use it to do the change because, you know, it could always be hacked and somebody else could come in there and put some other ideas and stuff. So they use it just to propose.
All right, we had another question right in the same row, I think. Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Iran, Bahrain, Yemen, Libya, all obviously inspired by Egypt. Has this kind of brought on more, even more of a sense of nationalism among the Egyptian people? You know, hey, look at what we did. You know, you can do the same thing.
Well, look at the Time magazine cover page. I think that we have a new Egypt, and I hope we have new Egyptians. And the atmosphere is amazing. The way people start talking about the future, about themselves. You know, I didn't go to Egypt for 15 years, and I went, the last time I went, I said, you know, this is Egypt, that was not Egyptians. I left a long time ago, but now I saw everybody, that's all the Egyptians I know before.
I would just add to that, yes, it's definitely whatever is going on in other countries is inspired by the Egyptians, as well as the Egyptians, you know, was inspired by Tunisians. But back to your questions, is this related to nationalism? Yes, because there have been for a long time the ban Arab nationalism, this kinds of ideology inherited in the heart and minds of Arabs in this region, but were minimized very much during the Qaddafi period in Libya, Mubarak's period in Egypt, and I would say clearly directly after the peace treaty with Israel that Sadat's initiated in Egypt. So people started to perceive that different Arab countries start to think of themselves as, you know, independence, and the notion of Arab nationalism and the ban Arab started to minimize. So I would say this revolution sort of woke up all of these feelings again, and people were inspired, and people are looking for, again, kinds of unity. in a way or another across the Arab countries.
Can I ask a question? Okay, let me ask you a question. You know, as a professor, I get used to ask a question more than to answer a question. And maybe this question will shock you a little bit, and maybe it will show the difference in the culture. What do you think if Mubarak died tomorrow? What do you think what will happen?
The same military will rule the country.
No, I think the only people who understand this are Egyptians and psychiatrists. The Egyptians, because I bet you there will be many hundreds of thousands go to respect the dead president, and I hate to say maybe million, because as Egyptian we respect our dead, doesn't matter what, and we have a long history of with the ancient Egyptian and their pharaohs. As the psychiatrists, I think many Egyptians they are suffering right now from separation. Because after 30 years under one ruler, they feel that there's something missing.
I would. Are you?
and also, please read. Reading assignment. Please read about Stockholm syndrome, when the captors have the tendency to like the victim like their captor.
I would just like to add to Dr. Diaz's comment. If you notice, the revolution, even, of course it was a revolution, but noticing the rest in peace, the dead total, or the dead count, it was a peaceful revolution. So backing up Dr. Diaz's comment, if Mubarak was to die tomorrow, regardless of every single person that was probably in the street, would probably at the same time show respect to Mubarak. Because it's not just about, we don't hate the country. And we don't hate we just hate what's happening, because it seems as if we're locked up to a point where we can't speak anymore. It's we want something, but we're not getting it. And again, adding to what Dr. Dion, my mom said, according to your nationalists, if you look at the similarities between all of those countries, you'd see that most of them were dictatorships, and you'd see that it's like if you have an older brother or a sibling in the family, one if he gets a piece of cake. The other brother or the other sister wants a piece. So when you see that happening, you want some of it. And when you see it happen successfully, then your eyes begin to widen and you're like, okay, I really want this, and hopefully it'll work. And if all these happen successfully, just like Tunisia and Egypt happened successfully, then it will come together in a way that it will be the true Middle East that hasn't been that the light hasn't been shed upon yet.
But by the way, notice that I said tomorrow. So if he died Wednesday, I no longer guarantee.
We probably should make mention of Libya. At the moment, some of you have been following that. Over the weekend, the Human Rights Watch said the death was probably 200. Then we had reports of 250 yesterday, and there's probably several more hundred today, if those reports are accurate. They still cannot be totally confirmed. Two pilots that were ordered to bomb, according to the pilots, the people in the demonstrations, instead flew to Malta this afternoon and have defected. The Libyan ambassador to the U.S. has defected. The United Nations ambassador from Libya has defected. There's reports that parts of Libya have fallen out of control of the government, and there's also reports of machine guns being fired into people. We had a couple more questions, and then we'll see how we are. Yes, sir.
On the Sudanese front, I had a chance to spend some time in Uganda, in the northern part of it, and the rebel army had left. And I'm very interested in the stability of the region, given what has gone on there. The situation in Somalia is still extremely volatile there. The U.S. has a large base right there in Djibouti that they used to maintain everything. I was stationed there for a while as well. How do you see the rest of the Horn of Africa panning out? There's not a lot of noise coming out of there as far as political unrest compared to what you have on the rest of the Middle East, but still a very volatile region, in my opinion.
Yeah, I think that's a very good question. That, you know, the reason referendum kind of show us that things can be done successfully, because before the referendum there was the impression that it will be chaotic. You know, there will be a lot of infighting or maybe a lot of sabotage and those kind of things. But if people are serious and you put rules in place to guide the process, I think what will happen in the Sudan and as well as maybe the closest neighbors is they will learn from the mistakes. The issue of LRA is a very serious issue. And you know, people are, you know, especially in Southern Sudan, there was an initiative to bring the LRA together with the Ugandan government. And that, you know, that failed. So the people in Southern Sudan are working very hard to make sure that the region is peaceful. And if it's not peaceful, it's not going to be because they're not trying. But you know, I'm very optimistic that it will be, you know, it will be peaceful. It's just a matter of finding the right piece and put them together.
Thank you. I think we'll give each of the panelists, including Ahmed and Dr. Gang, a chance to just say any comment they want. And we'll close by giving the podium back to Emily, who's in charge of this thing, actually. And she has a brief announcement of all of interest to everyone, and then we'll close. So, Ahmed, would you like to say any parting words? And thank you, by the way, for getting up at 2, 3, or 4 in the morning there.
Well, I would like to end it by saying the my favorite quote of the whole revolution, which was the people demand the removal of the regime. So I'll go ahead and say it. A shot.
يريد إسقاط النظام. يريد إسقاط النظام.
We lost your voice.
We lost the mic. We lost your mic, I think.
We lost.
Yeah.
We lost your mic.
Are you good? Okay. My favorite quote is "I akuma hishik hishik."
Wow, okay. I'm glad that was in Arabic. I'm glad that was in Arabic.
Wait, there are some...
They don't think that it was just by us Egyptians that we did this by ourselves. Also, people out there who supported us, who was always standing in the name of democracy, supported us. And we thank you. We thank every American citizen who prayed for us, so every American citizen who actually thought of us and texted us back on Facebook and faced the Egyptian flag like we did. It was amazing out of everybody out there from the West, from Asia. And thank you very much for having this forum as well.
Do you guys have anything?
Final words?
Okay.
Yes, please translate, and then if you're
clear. Oh, do you want me to translate really?
Yes, please.
Oh, okay. People who speak of Arabic, no, it's really hard, but Hishik Bishik is an exhibition that we use for belly dancers and performance. So, yeah, this is the easiest way to describe it. So they call the government as a government for Hishik Bishik, so for the playful and fun and dance, but not for the real work. But we will get to you and we will defeat you. So this is the meaning of... So Yahkuma Hishik Bishik, Bokra, tomorrow, we will defeat you, not the characters. Yeah, the people will defeat
you. I just have one addition for everybody or anybody who's interested in the Middle East and the whole the mind process of the Arab American. We have an up-and-coming organization called the Arab American Association, and there's a sign-up sheet in the back. Whoever would like to become a member, just add your name and your email, and we will contact you. And regarding the fact, just remove the whole Egyptian revolution out of mind right now. This was done before, so you will not just gain about Egypt, but you will have a better understanding of the culture. So that's all I want to add.
Dr. Dia?
I want to be sure this is recorded because I want to send it to my daughters and my son, and I want to end up by singing the Egyptian national thing. بلادي 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 لك حبي وفؤادي مصر يا أم البلاد أنت لك والعباد لا مالك
Thank you very much. Dr. Kang, please.
Yeah,
no, go ahead.
I didn't say my closing remarks. No, that's fine. But I really want to call for every person, American, Egyptians, Arab, just to please make our consciousness toward peace and freedom and the democracy in this region, and not to expect the worst, because collective consciousness, as I believe, really direct our reality. So please let us really see the future as bright, as better for the region and for the world. And thank you very much, very special thanks to Dr. Bob Bress and Emily for their efforts and for the great university, University of Southern Mississippi, my colleagues who supported me, and they are here. And I really feel like the university celebrated with us the success of this revolution so far, and we'll continue to celebrate. Thank you.
And Dr. Gang?
Yeah, quickly, I just want to add that we have a privilege here on campus. You know, the campus community has a privilege that most universities do not have, and that is exceptional faculty, not only in the classroom, but in the world of affairs. So when you take advantage of situations like this or problems like this, you can learn issues in a perspective that you can read in the news or see on TV. So when you look at this, what just happened in Egypt and Tunisia and all the other places is historic. You know, most people will look back to this 10 or 20 years from now and think that, man, I was part of something. You know, 20 years ago at Southern Miss in Liberal Art Building, I was addressed by Ahmed from Tahrir or from Cairo, and then you will feel a part of something. So this is to say that we have resources that we just have to learn how to use, and this is a very special occasion. I hope we can do more of this. And hopefully we will. Thank you.
As we look at the region, it's worth mentioning that most of sub-Saharan Africa during the 90s went through a very similar period of overthrowing dictators and autocrats. They've had different measures of success, but the fact that we're seeing something happening all across the Arab world should not make us discouraged that somehow this can all turn out bad. It could turn out pretty good, and there are still a lot of challenges ahead, but in sub-Saharan Africa compared to 1990, compared to today, it's a much more democratic place. I'd like to just give one round of applause for all of the panelists, including Ahmed.
Thank you again, panel. It was wonderful. And thank you, audience, for your questions. It just made it all work so much better. I do encourage you, if you're interested in, you know, the exciting time in the Middle East, to join the Arab American Association and sign on that sign-up sheet. And now I would like to have Dylan Harris come up. He's going to talk a little bit about the Center for Human Rights and Civil Liberties, which, like I mentioned briefly earlier, is becoming an organization of a bunch of different human rights groups on campus. So thank you again for coming, and I hope you learned something, and I implore you to share what you've learned with your family and friends. Thanks.
Thanks. I won't talk very long. Really, I want to thank the people who organized it too, and again, thank the speakers for speaking. This was put together in really 2 weeks, so this is something incredible that segue into something the Center for Human Rights and Civil Liberties can do. It's like she mentioned, something very new. It's been around for a couple of years, but some students and faculty are trying to revamp that. restructure it so it's more student-oriented. So there's student organizations here that study human rights. There's lots of faculty here whose work is oriented towards human rights, and we want to put those together in a sort of coalition that helps everyone out. So this is one event, and hopefully many to come. This is an example of something we can do. So as students, we can support it by coming to these things. There's a human rights minor if you're really stoked about it. There's plenty of professors here who would love to have you in their classes. And as a community, thanks for coming very much. And if you're interested also, we'll have more things like this in the future. Thank you. Thanks again for the speakers and the organizers. Okay.
And thank you again for coming. Have a good evening.
Congratulations.
Good job.
It was wonderful.
Can I say